you talk about the war in Iraq, you're actually talking about many different wars. The first war, the war of the Sunni insurgents, how did that start?
What we saw almost from the beginning is that elements from the military and from the Ba'ath Party and from within the Sunni community begin the insurgency. What started as small, ad hoc, without coordination, eventually emerged as a structured and extremely effective guerrilla fight. Now, these are the people who originally administration figures were calling dead-enders and criminal elements. Well, we've now seen that that's not the case. The Sunni insurgency is, by and large, the war that America went there to fight.
But the U.S. really hadn't expected there to be an insurgency at all.
By and large, no. They expected a much warmer reception. But with the disbandment of the military, with a lack of economic opportunity, and with what was perceived to be a heavy focus on the Shia, all these former generals and colonels and officers and foot soldiers felt that they were left with no other choice. Plus, one thing that's been significantly underestimated from the beginning is the Iraqi sense of nationalism, particularly among the Sunnis, or their sense of honour. These men were just sent home in what they felt was dishonour. They were no longer required and they were disempowered. Now, the way it began is that essentially small groups would just pick up arms and take pot shots at passing American convoys. But eventually one group started talking to another group. Then they'd start to coordinate, sharing weapons, sharing intelligence. Then command and control structures began to emerge.
Did they want Saddam back in power?
These soldiers, these generals, were not fighting for a return of Saddam at all. Indeed, the day Saddam was captured in December 2003 and word leaked the next morning, I was with Sunni insurgents, every one of them to a man said, this in no way affects what we're doing. We're not fighting for Saddam. Whilst this may be a symbolic body blow, this did not strike at the heart of the insurgency. That's what they said the day he was captured. And in the years since, we've seen that borne out.
So these aren't men who, at least initially, supported Al-Qaeda, who
absolutely
were...
not. In fact, in many ways, they were opposed to, if not Al-Qaeda, at least the idea of Al-Qaeda. And we certainly saw through the early years of the war, and to a degree continuing now, great friction between these elements of America's enemies.
So when did this first war, these Sunni insurgents, start to become more radicalized?
As we saw strains put on the insurgents' flow of finances and funding, we saw a growth in the power and influence of Al-Qaeda and other Islamists. And also, don't forget, what we now see as a civil war has pushed people on both sides to the extremes. So we're now seeing nationalists being herded towards Al-Qaeda. More and more we started to see foreign fighters appearing in Haifa Street, to the point where, by the end, Zarqawi's organization, which later became officially Al-Qaeda, was able to display its banners along the length of Haifa Street to take ownership of it over
nationalists. Al-Qaeda in Iraq could actually put its banners on a street in Baghdad, in central Baghdad.
Yes, they did. And this was a symbolic passing of power here in the center of the capital. Now, I personally experienced this just days after a blazing battle with US forces that left a Bradley armored fighting vehicle in flames. Zarqawi supporters were on top of it waving his flags. What happened is Al-Qaeda said, well, we now own this. So I went in there to document this, to see if it was true and to try and show this.
Are you nuts?
Well,
you ever ask yourself that?
Yes, often actually. But this is
I mean, that's a dangerous thing to do.
It is an extremely difficult thing to do, but I mean, this is a part of the nature of this, like every war, the fog of war. What's true and what's not? There's so much that we're told by all sides. I mean, this is one of the universal features of this war, as in all others, is that everybody lies. But I went in there, and sure enough, I found the banners. Sure enough, lining the streets were al-Zarqawi's fighters, these men who soon became fully fledged al-Qaeda. Now, what happened is that in the end, these men intercepted my vehicle, and with grenades with the pins pulled so that they were live, hauled me from the car, and with my own video camera, they were preparing to film my execution. So as far as we're aware, after that day on Hyper Street, I'm the only Westerner that we know of who's been in the control of Zarqawi's organization, Al-Qaeda, and to have lived to tell the tale.
How did you get out of it?
I was in a vehicle with a mid-ranking Iraqi insurgent commander who'd told me of Zarqawi's takeover, essentially complained about it. And I said, well, I need to see this. So he took me in there to show me that these radicals, these foreign Islamists, have taken our territory. When the foreign radical Islamists, essentially who became Al-Qaeda, dragged me from the car, this man was left to negotiate for my life. And this is where we see the difference come into play. The Zarqawi fighters wanted to execute the Westerner. As they said, you bring a Westerner in here and you expect us to let him leave alive? Well, no, it doesn't work like that. So even though these Islamists at that time had the upper hand in Haifa Street, they couldn't discount the local fighters. And essentially it came down to the local Iraqi insurgents saying, okay, you can kill this foreigner, but know that that means we go to war. Because he has come here at our invitation. And for you to kill him is essentially an insult to us. And as much as these foreign fighters wanted to kill me, at the end of the day, they knew that practically they couldn't, because they could not afford to have this local fight. And it was through gritted teeth that they essentially gave me back to the Iraqi insurgents, who then took me out.
What was that feeling like when you realized you were going to live?
It took a long time before it actually dawned on me. I spent many of the following days in my room. I found it very difficult to leave the safety and comfort of my bedroom. It took some time for me to regather myself and to return to the streets. But in fact, just days later, I did return to this very place.
You went back to Haifa Street?
I went back to Haifa Street. Not too precisely the same area, but yes, I did go probing back into this area during some fighting.
That is when the second war in Iraq begins, and we'll talk about that, the rise of Al-Qaeda, and the man who changed it all, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi. We'll be right back.